thank you for taking the time to learn more about workplace safety. Over the next few minutes, I'd like to fill you in on what's coming up in this online course on ladder safety. Overall, this course will take about an hour to complete. It's divided into 5 modules, each covering a different aspect of ladder safety. This course is designed to ensure you have a solid foundation to build or manage your own ladder safety program. It is not designed to be a replacement for your company's ladder training, as it does not meet all requirements for employee training. However, we recommend that you use this course as a supplement to enhance certain aspects of your training program. For your convenience, each of the videos in this course are available for download on our website and on our YouTube channel. We interviewed knowledgeable users of ladders to provide an opportunity to present this information to you. We begin by discussing common types of ladders, portable ladders, fixed ladders, and mobile ladder stands and platforms. We cover the basics of selecting the right ladder for the job, proper usage, inspection, and maintenance. Once you've completed this ladder safety course, there are 4 other courses in the Fall Protection Suite to choose from. These are Fundamentals of Fall Protection for Roofing, Fall Protection in Construction, and Walking Working Surfaces. At the end of this course, you'll be asked to provide your name, email address, and CCB number if that's applicable. We'll use this information to generate a certificate of completion and ensure that you get proper continuing education credits. If you have any questions along the way, feel free to give us a call at 503-947-7443 or email ed.webb@oregon.gov. Let's get started.
Falls are the leading cause of unintentional injury nationwide, and sometimes they can even be deadly, especially when you fall from a ladder.
A man working on a ladder in Alva was killed when it fell against a power line. Now, this happened in near the Alva Cemetery on Docks Lane. Lee County deputies say the man fell off the ladder and EMS did CPR, but he unfortunately died on the scene.
Once you start using a ladder improperly, one of 2 things: you lack training or you lack knowledge. Once you get up here, and let's even say you fall from 6 feet, you're probably doing 10, 15 miles per hour. And again, it depends on how you fall. If you fall, you know, if you fall horizontally and you bounce off the concrete, I promise you, bad things are gonna happen. But if you fall vertically, maybe land on your legs, it still could happen because of the forces. With that much force and you hit, there's a good chance you're gonna blow a disc or 2. And then there's a really good chance you could break your back.
Ladders are one of the leading causes of injury in construction or in general industry.
A tragic fatal accident. He got caught in the inactive machinery as he was making an adjustment and then fell from the ladder he was on. And now OSHA is investigating the circumstances leading up to the victim succumbing to severe upper body injuries.
There's no reason to put your business at risk, your life at risk, and your people that are going to work for you at risk of a fall from improper ladder or improper fall protection. There's nothing more important than you going home to your family at night, healthy and happy, because you're the boss. You got to go home and do 3-4 hours worth of paperwork. Don't expose them to those hazards. Those are controllable hazards that are not necessary to happen on the job.
If you're on a ladder and you're not trained and you're not using the ladder properly, there is a really high probability that you will get hurt.
When it comes to ladders, although there's many different types, it's also one of those tools that most of us have used that we don't really give much of a second thought. And they're also one of the most dangerous tools, because anytime we use a tool and we don't give it its due diligence about properly inspecting it and using it in the proper perspective, again, we go back to the, oh, I used it this way that one time and nothing bad happened. Then we get to the, oh, that's acceptable because nothing came back and hit me enough that it told me that it was dangerous. And ladders have traditionally been a very dangerous thing. Look at the fall statistics from ladders. They're very dangerous. However, the ladders that we use in today's market versus ladders of yesteryear, shall we say, are a lot better. There are ladders on the market now that have platforms. Some have platforms with a little gate so you can walk up. They're adjustable and each leg is adjustable. So instead of grabbing a brick, digging a hole to get your ladder leveled, there's actual leveling feet on each one of the four posts, or ones that even as you extend it will have outriggers to give better stability on the left, right, or the tip over. It still comes down to best practices. Always keep your belt buckle inside the rails, 3 points of contact while you're climbing up and down, 2 feet in a hand, 2 hands in a feet. Again, never assume that ladders are always safe, because the ladder, if used properly, can be a very safe and effective tool. Just use it in the right way or use the correct ladder for the scenario.
Before we get into the next module, let's briefly go over which standards are commonly referenced when it comes to ladders. Employers have the responsibility to provide a safe workplace and to communicate safety requirements to their employees. The purpose of this video is to help you become familiar with widely used OSHA safety standards that relate to ladders. OSHA standards are the minimum rules that describe the methods that employers must use to protect their employees from hazards. Please keep in mind that while employers working in locations under federal OSHA's jurisdiction will follow federal OSHA's regulations, there are some states and territories that have adopted their own ladder regulations. The state of Oregon is a good example of that, and this training is based on Oregon OSHA's ladder standards, which you can get from our website, osha.oregon.gov. Once the page loads, click on A to Z Topics in the top left corner. From there, select L. Select Ladders. Then, select Rules. Ladder use in general industry is covered in Oregon OSHA's Division 2, Subdivision D, titled Walking Working Surfaces. The term general industry refers to all industries not engaged in agriculture, construction, maritime, and forestry activities. At the time of this recording, the majority of general industry ladder requirements are found in pages D11 through D22. Ladder use in construction activities is covered in Oregon OSHA's Division 3, Subdivision X, titled Stairways and Ladders. You'll notice the ladder requirements here are very similar to those in the General Industry Walking Working Surfaces Standard. Ladders for agriculture activities are covered in Oregon OSHA's Division 4, Subdivision D, Work Surfaces. We won't be delving into the requirements for agriculture in this course. For more information, please refer to the A to Z Topic Index on our website. And finally, if you are using ladders with scaffolding, please refer to Oregon OSHA's Division 3, Subdivision L for scaffolds. You'll find this in the scaffold section of the A to Z Topic Index. This standard applies to both general industry and construction activities. We'll be going over scaffolding in another course called Fall Protection in Construction. It will be of great value to you and your company to have a good knowledge of the OSHA standards that relate to your industry and how to apply them.
Ladder safety is you've got to pick the right ladder for the job. A lot of times, you know, I know a lot of injuries have happened because a guy gets to a job site. We had it happen over in Lincoln City. Guy gets to a job site, the wall's 24 feet, and he's got a 20-foot ladder, extension ladder. The only problem is when he pushes off, what happens? The ladder kicks out. He hits the ground. Why? Because the office was 13 miles away. It's most important to pick the right ladder for the job you're going to do.
The right ladder for the right job. That's making sure that ladder safely accesses where you're going to go. If you got to go up on a two-story roof and you only have a 20-foot ladder, it's not going to give you the extension you need to get over the edge of the of the roof. You're not going to have anything to tie to. You're not going to have your 3 feet over.
We did an investigation where a employer selected an orchard ladder to be used. And in this situation, the orchard ladder has a third leg, and that third leg is designed to penetrate into soft soil. In this situation, the employer set the orchard ladder up on a smooth concrete surface, and the third leg was not able to penetrate into the smooth concrete, and there was no sort of device to prevent the third leg from spreading. Essentially, there was no spreader bar. The employee set up the orchard ladder correctly, but set it up on a surface that wasn't appropriate. And so when the employee climbed up on the orchard ladder, their weight pressing down caused the third leg to slide out from underneath them because the orchard ladder couldn't penetrate into the concrete, and the employee fell to the ground receiving severe injuries.
So we try to have a kickoff meeting before every project in the office. You know, what they're doing, what kind of work, where they're at, what the building is, what's the product. And then, you know, we talk about ladders or scissor lifts or boom lifts or whatever they're going to need where they're working. And, you know, how high is the ceiling? Well, the ceiling's 14 feet. Oh, so you're going to need 10-foot ladders, right? Oh, that's right. I got to get 10-foot ladders. Okay, so let's not take any 6-footers out there because we won't need them. So that planning, it's that proper planning. If you don't have the right ladder, your job's going to take longer because you're struggling. It's going to be more hazardous because you're struggling and you're not comfortable. And and when you raise the hazard level, I raise my incident level. And I don't need you to do that. You need to go home every day healthy and safe, get the right products.
Selecting the right ladder. Selecting the right ladder is very important. Selecting the wrong ladder could lead to serious injury or death. Many people are only familiar with common types of ladders, but there are many types that perform better for different tasks. Below are a few things you should consider when selecting your ladder: work environment, ladder type, load capacity, material, height and reach, maneuverability, condition of ladder. Load capacities. Each ladder type has a load capacity rating based on the kind of ladder. There are 5 different load capacities, and each have their own label. Type 3, 200 pounds. Typical uses include painting, yard work, and household chores. Type 2, 225 pounds. Typical uses include light commercial, painting, cleaning, and light repair. Type 1, 250 pounds. Typical uses include maintenance and drywall. Type 1A, 300 pounds. Typical uses include construction and roofing. Type 1AA, 375 pounds. Typical uses include heavy duty, industrial, and construction. The maximum weight includes both the weight of the worker and materials or equipment the worker might be carrying. Overloading a ladder could cause it to fail. Ladder material. Fiberglass ladder. Fiberglass ladders are strong, lightweight, and electrically non-conductive. Aluminum ladder. Aluminum ladders are lightweight and must not be used when performing tasks on or near electrical wiring. Wood ladder. Wood ladders are heavier than both aluminum and fiberglass ladders. They can rot, but are electrically non-conductive.
So one of the things that we do also for our safety training is on ladder inspections and how to set them up. We have a prop here in our shop that we use to do that. But what we really try to get to the guys is making sure that they inspect their ladder before every use. And so when they pull them out of the truck, I have them start looking at the ladder. And then when they get it to the point where they're setting up, then they're really looking over all the components. So the components that we're looking for is the rails of both sides, making sure there's no cracks in any of it. Looking at each of the rungs, make sure there's no damage, no bent, no cracks either. We use a lot of fiberglass ladders too, so we talk about those points that what we can see is cracks in the rails because of the fiberglass and how they're used. So we have them go through that. And then the feet of the ladder, making sure that the rubber part of that is secured. And if it sets in the ground, they have to set it on grass or just open ground, that they're using the spikes, that they're turning that up and using those spikes in the ground so they get a nice, compact, secure footing for each of the legs of the ladder. We also talk about then the 4-to-1 rating, making sure that for every 4 foot up, it's 1 foot away. And how we really focus on this prop is because it's real world examples is kind of what we're seeing, is that they take that measurement from the roof edge and not from the wall of the house, because that can throw that math off and they get it wrong. So we talk to them a lot about that, making sure that it's at the roof edge. That's where you move out. So in this particular case, it's set up about 8 foot, so it needs to be 2 feet out from the roof edge. And so that's how we have that set out. The other thing that we talk about too is making sure that it's properly secured. So we use a product called Ladder's Little Helper. Basically, that's put together to make sure that we don't damage the gutter, but also it helps them to remember the whole process. So the whole process, set the gutter protector, the helper, and then set the ladder, and then go up and use the cord to secure that in place. So when they have all those components, they remember that process and do that every time they set up a ladder. So we do this for new hire orientation. We use these props. We'll also use them as reminders during safety meetings. But then also too, we're checking to make sure that this is done in the field exactly the way we trained it to be.
When I'm inspecting a ladder, what am I looking for? I have a 75-page technical data sheet book that will tell you everything you're looking for. But on a job site, when you're doing it, the very first thing is it's got to have tags. It's got to all have all the tags, and they've got to be legible.
You can't change anything about that ladder that the manufacturer originally put on that ladder, built it to that standard, and tested it. So it's a real risk. But we do require the employer to know what that ladder is designed to do, what its maximum weights are. So everything that is on a label, the employer is supposed to know that.
Inspection, we always recommend that you follow the manufacturer's recommendations for inspections. You always want to start at the base of the ladder and work your way up. Make sure that the feet are in good condition, any pads, everything is operating properly. Look at the side rails, make sure that they're still tight. Look at each and every single rung or step, make sure that there's no dents, no damage, no punctures, excessive splinters or fraying, loose materials. Make sure the spreader bars, if they're equipped, that the spreader bars still engage properly. And just give the portable ladder an overall top to bottom visual inspection, physically feeling each component, making sure that it still meets the original manufacturer's specifications.
Regarding our ladders and inspections, the crews have been trained to inspect if it's dented, if it's bent, if something's just not right, obviously not to use it, red tag it, let their supervisor know, and then our safety director will go out and inspect it and determine that, hey, this is, we can't repair it, then we'll cut them up, throw them away, recycle them, actually is what we normally do, and just to make sure that they're not being used. And then also when safety director is going out doing job site audits every week, every day, he's going to be looking at those ladders when he's there too. So if he sees something that the crew may have missed, that's kind of our second line of defense to ensure that they're using safe ladders.
But as far as maintenance goes to a ladder, if that ladder is broken, cracked, bent, faded, in the garbage it goes. You can't do it. Once a ladder's broken, it's broken. It's done. You're not going to fix the fiberglass. If you lose, you know, these rivets are put in a special way. You're not going to re-rivet it with a, you know, an AA rivet. There's no way. So the idea about it is once it can't pass inspection, what do you do with it? You destroy it. See, you don't send it home with an employee that needs a ladder at home. Because if it won't pass inspection on the job site, is it now going to pass inspection at your house? And then it fails, and then he comes back to you and says, you gave me a bad ladder. So yeah, destroy it. Just destroy it.
Inspection form. Even though Oregon OSHA does not require you to keep a record of your ladder inspections, it is much easier to prove you did it if you have the paperwork. The benefit is you can also see if there are trends developing, like defective parts. If any defect or damage is found during the inspection, you must do the following. Tag the ladder, dangerous, do not use. Repair the ladder immediately to original condition, or destroy the ladder.
A portable ladder means a ladder that can readily be moved or carried and usually consists of side rails joined at intervals by steps, rungs, or cleats. Now, Oregon OSHA has a few additional rules for portable ladders, and those additional rules apply to both non-self-supporting ladders and self-supporting ladders. A self-supporting ladder is a class of portable ladders that, by design, stand on their own when erected for use without assistance from external structures. Step ladders, double front ladders, platform ladders, trestle ladders, and articulating ladders set up as in a stepladder mode are examples of self-supporting ladders. Additionally, we have a definition for non-self-supporting ladders, and that is a class of portable ladders that, by design, must be placed against a structure independent of itself, such as a wall, to remain standing for use. Single ladders, extension ladders, sectional ladders, and articulating ladders set up in a straight ladder mode are examples of non-self-supporting ladders.
Tips for using the ladder. Do not exceed the maximum total load. Do not exceed the maximum users on the ladder. Keep your belt buckle between the rails when using the ladder. Maintain at least 3 points of contact while ascending or descending the ladder. Wear suitable footwear when using the ladder. Do not overreach while on the ladder. Do not move the ladder while on it. Do not push or pull objects while on the ladder. Self-supporting ladders. Self-supporting ladders are ladders that have 3 or 4 side rails. When these ladders are set up, they have the ability to stand on their own without any assistance, such as a wall. Multiple configuration ladders, such as articulated ladders, based on the manufacturer's approved configuration selected by the user, will either be self-supporting or non-self-supporting. A ladder cannot be both at the same time.
So let's talk a little bit about the different generations of ladders that have come out here in the last few years. There have been some really drastic changes, so we're going to give you an idea. This is the new podium ladder. So the idea about it is if you have a fixed level that you're going to work at constantly over and over and over again, this is the best way to do it. And the number one reason is you got a work platform. It makes a difference. So with this ladder, you can actually work with your back to the back side. You can work facing this way out on this ladder. So you can work in a 360 degree. Now, in a ladder this size, you only get 4 feet. So you gotta keep that in mind, because you do lose all this.
But then what is all this being lost? What did that do? We have control over it. And so we have the ability. This is just one of the new generation ladders. This is a 375 pound ladder. They're a little more bulky, but they're a lot more consistent. You could work off of these rungs right here, but you have to stay facing the ladder. Okay, but once you get up here, again, it's a work platform. So you can work in 360 degrees. So it's just, I think it takes a lot of issue out. The other thing that's out now, and a lot of people see it, unlike this ladder, you are not allowed to climb up on the backside of this ladder at all. But now we do have ladders that you can do that. It's called a twin step, and it's 375 pounds on each side. Okay, so you could have two full-size guys working off the same ladder. That way you have four hands instead of two. They're great, and they're a really good utility tool. If you ask me, this is probably the smartest thing ladders have done in a long, long time, just because, again, we can control you standing on it, where you're gonna stand on it. It's gotta be a consistent thing. You go to that same height every time because you're not gonna gain any height from this.
Lean safe ladders. Lean safe ladders are uniquely designed to securely lean against flat wall surfaces, wall corners, poles, and wall studs, and perform as a standard stepladder. Leaning a standard stepladder is not an option on a job site, so always read your manufacturer's instructions and make sure you have the right ladder for the job. Telescopic extension ladders. Telescopic extension ladders are uniquely designed to collapse for easy transportation and storage. There are a variety of different telescopic extension ladders that come with different specifications. Always read your manufacturer's instructions and make sure you have the right ladder for the job. Orchard ladders. Orchard ladders lack a locking spreader bar between the front and rear legs. An orchard ladder's feet are metal and designed to slightly penetrate firm soil to create a secure footing. They lack slip-resistant pads needed for use on hard surfaces. Therefore, an orchard ladder would not be appropriate on polished concrete, even though the concrete is both level and firm. Non-self-supporting ladders. Non-self-supporting ladders, when erected, have two side rails, legs, and must lean against a strong, stable structure to remain standing. This structure provides all non-self-supporting ladders with an upper support, also known as a top support. A signature requirement for all non-self-supporting ladders, unless instructed otherwise by the manufacturer, is ensuring that the proper setup angle of 75.5 degrees from the horizon is achieved. Multiple configuration ladders, such as articulated ladders, based on the manufacturer's approved configuration selected by the user, will either be self-supporting or non-self-supporting. A ladder cannot be both at the same time. Access to upper landing. When portable ladders are used for access to an upper landing, they need to have the side rails extended at least 3 feet above the upper landing. Do not place any weight on the rungs located above the upper landing when using non-supporting ladders to access an upper level.
When it comes to ladder safety, of course, always following the manufacturer's instructions is paramount to make sure that we're using it in the right manner. But there are a lot of ladder accessories that help make current ladders safer or make it more advantageous to use in certain environments. Now, what we're gonna do is we're gonna take this little 3-foot extension ladder and show you a few options that are available. Anybody that's worked on a ladder, an extension ladder for any period of time, say a painter or a framer or anyone, those rungs, even though they're flatter now than they used to be, those can be very tiring on the feet. So giving ourselves the ability to have a better platform, A, can make it safer, and then makes us less tired and makes the work a little more enjoyable. So one option, as there are a couple devices out there, but in this particular one, where you can carry this up in your pouch or your work pouch, and easily as you climb up, easily one-handed install it, and all it does is uses a pressure connection like that. And if we have the ladder at the correct degree, now it becomes a flat platform. So instead of that 2-inch or 1.5-inch rung, Now we have almost a full footprint of a rung. So as you can see here, instead of standing on that little side, now when a person is standing on that at the proper degree, it almost takes up a good 50 to 60% of the foot. It will help alleviate some of the stress to the foot and the amount of time that you can work up there comfortably. Because remember, if we climbed up the ladder, we're gonna have to have the legs to climb down the ladder. One of the other devices that can be used in ladder safety is when we have to climb ladders to use for access egress to get onto an upper working surface, is the requirement is that the ladder extension shall extend no less than 3 feet above. And the premise behind that is so that we have a handhold to get over so we can climb off onto the walking surface. But in that aspect, as you climb up, now we have to cross the ladder and cross over like this. And getting onto the ladder, then we have to walk towards the surface, and then we have to come and throw our body around to find where that footprint is. Now, I'm not saying this is going to create an injury, but most injuries and incidents that occur on ladders is during that transition because we're climbing away and swinging around. Make sure that you always secure the ladder at the top so it doesn't slide and level it on the bottom. But one option that is available that I'm a fan of is ladder extensions. Now, once this gets installed, where we're gonna make this little 3-footer, we're gonna make it a little taller. And of course, always consult the manufacturer's instructions, but it can be as simple as sliding it on like that and then twisting the dial like this. Now it's fully secured to the ladder. Now, this extension is 3 foot over. Now, instead of walking around the ladder, even with the tool bags, the human being walks through the ladder. Nice handhold, and there's a way to actually be safer as we extend. So that little 3-foot ladder has now become 6 foot.
What accessories are available for ladders? Oh my God, it's infinitive. Okay, you got everything from leg levelers to pole holders. So we got these Vs. So guys on extension ladders that are going up a pole can put it on the pole so the ladder won't tip. So you're going up on a roof, you gotta tie your ladder off. Okay, you know what the rat tails are, the rafter tails that come out. You just put it on there, clamp it down, hook it around your ladder's tied off. Wall mounts are big, for painters especially. The U's that come out, and they go on your extension ladder so you can lean it right against the wall and work off of it. Pump jacks, ladder planks, I mean, you name it, they got it now. So there's no reason that you can never say, we couldn't secure that ladder.
So employers need to make sure that when they're instructing employees on how to set up a ladder, when they're training them on how to use a ladder, that they are training first and foremost to the manufacturer's instructions. The manufacturer knows how the ladder is designed to be used, what it is intended to be used for, and they need to be following those instructions. But generally, we want to make sure that the ground conditions are satisfactory to support the load, which is why we have rules that say you can't set ladders up on top of boxes or barrels and that sort of stuff. If it's going to be set up in outdoor situations, that the ground is firm enough, that it is level, so the foundation where you're setting up the ladder is appropriate. Next, we'd want to make sure that the location where the ladder is being set up is appropriate. So we'd always want to look overhead, make sure that there is no electrical hazards while we're setting up the ladder or where the ladder is going to be used. We'd want to make sure that the ladder is in a safe location. So a ladder that is set up in front of a doorway, and once the employee goes up on that ladder, they're trusting that no one is going to open that door and knock them off or displace them off of the ladder. So forethought needs to be put into the actual placement of the ladder. How do we block or barricade or lock that door, or post another employee in front of that door instructing people that the door is not available for use until the person is off of the ladder?
We're always going to look at non-self-supporting ladders to make sure that the ladder is set up in the correct angle to make sure that the ladder can properly support the person who is on it. And then anytime a ladder is used to gain access to a higher level, part of that setup is to make sure that the ladder is sufficiently long enough that the ladder extends a minimum of 3 feet above the point where the employee is going to be stepping off of the ladder onto the upper structure. Oftentimes, securing the ladder to prevent movement when the employee is stepping off of the ladder needs to be taken into consideration there also. So those are just a few things that an employer should think about when they're setting up the ladder, but ultimately they're going to follow the manufacturer's instructions for ladder usage.
You know, a lot of guys don't know what the calculation is for a ladder, 1 to 4. So for every 4 feet it goes up, you have to be 1 foot back. How to check that, because if it's too steep, you'll tip back. If it's too flat, it'll kick out. So you see a lot of guys that just don't understand that, just throw a ladder up. And once they throw a ladder up, they think, oh, I'm good. They don't tie their ladder off. Okay, a lot of people think, oh, I just have to tie it off at the top. A lot of times, no. If you're near a hole or a garbage chute or anything like that, you need to secure the bottom feet too, because if it kicks out, you know, that's just to make sure it doesn't slide. They have straps and everything now that you can just go around the bottom rung and go back in. So that's, you know, those are the major things you see. You got to think about it this way. Here's how the fall works. Okay, you put an extension ladder up to the roof. Okay? You have a foot on a movable object. Then you got a foot on a non-movable object, the roof or the platform. You're going to push off the movable object with the foot, and what's gonna move? The movable object. And that's because you didn't tie your ladder off before you got out and it kicked out sideways on you. So those are the mistakes we see a lot of times, you know? The other mistake is, in order for you to exit a ladder to get on a platform or any kind of roof or anything, you have to be at least 3 feet above the surface with your ladder, 3 rungs.
NIOSH Ladder Safety App. Scan the QR code to download the NIOSH Ladder App. The app can help with planning, selection, inspection, setup, proper use, accessories. The app is only available on mobile devices, for example, cell phones, tablets.
So ladder stands and platforms are basically almost a combination between a ladder and a stair. So they have certain provisions. Number one, they have handrails or stair rails on each side. You have to be sure that you maintain that. The ladder cannot shift and move while a person is on it, because often those stairs go up 10, 12 feet in the air. And if it has a platform at the top, such as you would use in a stocking room, a warehouse, then the guardrails have to extend around that platform as well. So those are guardrails at the top, and they're 42 inches high with mid rails, and then those are stair rails going down those steps. So if you are an employer who owns that type of equipment, you have to inspect it. You have to be certain that it stays in good shape, that it locks when it's locked, that it won't move, that someone can't end up on that platform picking up a heavy box or something from a rack and then falling off of that, either down those steps or over the edge.
Generally, ladder stands and ladder stand platforms are mobile pieces of equipment. They're large. They're heavy, they take up a lot of space, and they receive a lot of abuse. They're very useful tools, but they're oftentimes used in warehouses to reach product on storage racks, that sort of stuff. So when they're not in use, oftentimes they're roughly handled, they're shoved into corners, they're moved around with forklifts. And so the ladder stands can be damaged. So we need to make sure that they're being inspected prior to each use. Make sure that the casters, which they ride on, are not damaged, that the locking mechanisms
are still in good shape. Oftentimes, ladder stands and ladder stand platforms are used to gain access to shelving where heavy products are being removed or placed. And those products, when they're dropped, can actually damage the steps. So an inspection to make sure that the steps are still level and are in good shape need to occur. It's quite frequent that we inspect them and there will be damaged steps, damaged casters, or the entire unit is damaged because it's been struck by a forklift or other heavy machinery, because people just generally don't take care of them because they take them for granted. First of all, a fixed ladder is defined in the rules. So a fixed ladder means a ladder with rails or individual rungs that is permanently attached to a structure, building, or equipment. Fixed ladders include individual rung ladders, but not ship stairs, step bolts, or manhole steps. So you commonly find fixed ladders in locations where there is a permanent piece of equipment and there isn't enough room for a stairway. So a means of access in the form of a ladder that is permanent will be installed. So it becomes a fixed ladder. So instead of using a portable ladder to get to the elevation between different runways, you'll have a fixed ladder that is installed and is left behind as a permanent structure. Protection from falls are required in the rules, and there is a specific section just for fixed ladders, and that's one of the trigger heights. So anytime that a employee is going to be climbing a length that is 24 feet or greater above a lower level, some sort of protection is going to need to be provided for that employee when they're climbing the ladder. And so that lower level is really the important part when you're making the measurement. That 24 foot climb is going to be taking into account whether or not the platform below is large enough to reasonably catch the employee. If it's not, then you would measure to the level that is below that platform. The walking working surfaces require that when the length of climb up a fixed ladder is greater than 24 feet, the employer needs to provide protection for the employees from falls. In the future, that's going to be limited to a ladder climbing safety system or a personal fall arrest system. Currently, the use of a cage or a well is still allowed as a form of fall protection, but there is a definitive date where the cage or the well will no longer be allowed to be used as a form of fall protection when climbing a ladder.
We've talked about the fixed ladders and the new 1910, or the general industry's walking working surfaces, and the change for fixed ladders. The items that we are now encouraged or required to use are either a ladder safety system, such as what's installed in here, which is a cable system that is attached to the fixed ladder that you would use a traveler that would connect to here and then connect to the sternum ring or the chest ring of the worker, so that as they climb, it travels with them and below them, so that if they fall, it will engage and lock into the cable. Another device is that of doing a personal fall arrest system, either a ladder that is designed as an anchorage that you can use your retractables or your lanyards to connect to and climb vertically, or a fixed anchorage with a retractable with a tagline that you can pull down. With fixed ladder systems, some of the things that you have to be aware of is that now the fixed ladder becomes an anchorage. So what's gonna have to be done before a fixed ladder safety system can be installed, is you're gonna have to verify that this structure and the ladder are capable of sustaining the loads, because now it becomes a arrest system. Additionally, assure that you get systems that will extend past the top of the ladder so that the worker has something to hold on to by requirement and best practice, and so that they don't have to be on the ladder to connect and disconnect. They can actually step off of the ladder and then disconnect from the safety system. If you go into places where there is a roof hatch or a closed hatch and they have to climb up, there are other devices that can match or mount to the fixed ladder that will extend up so that they still have the handhold that they can use or as an anchorage that they can affix to, then raise it up and exit that way, remaining 100% connected. Not every ladder safety system is designed as well as others. Just make sure you, again, choose the right tool for the job and you follow the instructions to make sure that this and how it's attached to the structure are secure.
Oregon fall protection for fixed ladders. Fixed ladders over 24 feet installed before November 1st, 2019. The following four options are acceptable until December 1st, 2036. Personal fall arrest system, ladder safety system, cage, well. Fixed ladders over 24 feet installed on or after November 1st, 2019. The following two options are acceptable. Personal fall arrest system, ladder safety system.
One of the classic mistakes people make on ladders is overreaching. They overextend. Once you get that belt buckle outside of that rail, okay, you're in trouble because the ladder wants to go that way and you want to go that way. So they don't work together very well that way, okay? Do you know what a CAS is? A controlled access zone. So you're working in front of a door, right? And you don't put any tape or delineators up. Some dude comes flying through that door and takes your ladder out. Yeah, because you didn't control the area. You know, it's your responsibility to control that area.
So what are the hazards we have with ladders on the construction project or even on the maintenance project? Don't use the not a step. The top two are not a step. It says right on there, not a step. I don't care if you paint it off or it's chipped off. It's not a step. It's not a good place for you to stand. You don't have any balance up there. It's way too easy to tip out. The other biggest hazards are making sure your ladder is set up properly. We're in a tight area. You can't get it open. Is that ladder set up so it's not going to fall? The manufacturer says the cross arms will be locked in place. Is that really always required? You need to make sure that you're setting yourself up properly. Probably some of the biggest hazards we have associated to ladders are other objects that are in the ceiling. Going up to get to our ductwork, to install our ductwork, and running into ceiling wires or running into hangers or conduits or pipes, things like that. So it's that whole project hazard. Now that you're raised up on a ladder, you're in a fixed spot. You can always hit your head, hit your shoulder. If you have to carry something up your ladder and both hands are full, then we need to find a better way to do it. Where's your partner? Where's your rope? Let's set this up right.
Generally, one of the hazards of using a fixed ladder is that fixed ladder has been around for a long time. So someone needs to periodically inspect it to make sure that it is still in good condition. Fixed ladders are oftentimes in locations where cranes are being used. So in a manufacturing facility, they may be using a crane to move materials around as they're building new product. Those cranes, the forklifts, the materials being moved around can strike a fixed ladder and no one even pays attention to it. No one even notices it until 6 months later when the maintenance personnel need to go onto the roof via the fixed ladder. And at that point in time, they encounter a damaged fixed ladder. So fixed ladders are oftentimes exposed to outdoor elements, to the weather. They can rust, they can degrade over time. So the hazards are that they're not used very often, but when they're used, people generally don't take the time to properly check them out before they're used to make sure that they're in good condition. In general, an employer should always follow the manufacturer's recommendations for storing and maintaining and even disposal of a portable ladder. In general, we want to store portable ladders in a fashion where they're not going to get damaged. So an example of that is a wooden ladder, if it is stored improperly, can begin to sag and lose its straightness of its side rails if it's stored at an angle outside within the weather. that sort of stuff. You generally don't want to store a ladder with other materials on top of it. So you'd never want to use your ladder as a shelf and then store extra materials on top of that ladder.
These guys that have service vans, what do? They throw their ladders on the top of the service vans. So, you know, you go from a day being 45 to here come Monday or Tuesday, it's going to be 90. So they see all this temperature change, and that can really affect a ladder. If you can get them out of the weather once in a while, you know, but if they're going to sit on your truck 365, you know, it's going to be inevitable. They're going to fade. They're going to spider web and stuff like that. The other thing is, don't drag them off your rack and let them bounce off the ground. That just blows them apart. They're fiberglass.
How to store your ladder. Use a well-ventilated storage area. Store wood and fiberglass away from excessive moisture, heat, and sunlight. Keep them away from stoves, steam pipes, or radiators. Store non-self-supporting ladders in flat racks or on wall brackets that will prevent them from sagging. Store step ladders vertically in a closed position to reduce the risk of sagging or twisting. Secure them so that they won't tip over if they are struck. Keep material off ladders while they are stored.